when you look at socialism, we obviously have all this, you know, these trends in history that no one wants. But also in the past, you look at most of capitalism. And I'm a free market guy like anybody else, but you can't help but look at the past of imperialism, colonialism, and everything that has happened under the vehicle of capitalism.
Really?
As a historical, well, if you look at the arguments from the left, right? As far so that's the past. How do we redefine or change the narrative about the past and capitalism's role?
Yeah,
right?
I think a lot of work has been done in this area. I mean, I didn't touch upon this because this is, I think, pretty well-covered ground. First is, look, I'm not crazy about the term capitalism.
Right.
I think it has Marxist connotations, and it's kind of misleading because it implies that it's about capital. Whereas I like free markets because they're about spontaneous order, cooperation, they're about freedom, they're about letting people figure out what they want to do, and eventually we end up producing more plenty for everyone. So I find that, you know, one way to help ourselves is, I prefer free markets to the word capitalism. Second, on the historical front, I mean, look, you know, imperialism and colonialism have nothing to do with free markets. Free markets are about people voluntarily producing, trading, and exchanging with one another. Colonialism and imperialism are about one people ruling another one without their consent. If there is one thing that markets are all about, it is consent. You don't need to buy anything you want, and you don't need to buy it at the price you don't want to buy it. So these things don't go together. In terms of the good that markets have done, I mean, I don't know, take any graph beginning in about, the 18th century of the standard of living for all of humanity and look at what happens over the next 200-300 years. I mean, a colossal uplift of everyone across the board at uneven rates, mind you. Free markets have never promised that everyone would rise at the same rate, but it has lifted billions and billions of people out of poverty. I mean, look at China, right? China is another one of those hybrid models. They are authoritarian when it comes to politics and religion and free speech, but they also have this hybrid system when it comes to economics. Part of what has fueled the colossal growth of China in recent decades is the reforms they started implementing in the 80s to liberalize their economy. So there is, I think that free markets have an undeniable, spectacular track record of lifting billions of human beings out of poverty. And then I would tell the left, what is your track record? What does central planning and socialism have to show as a track record? 100 million dead bodies by the most conservative estimate. So that is not to say that markets can solve everything. Again, this is guarding against the libertarian fallacy. To say that, oh, well, markets work really well at this, let's just have markets do everything. Let's get rid of countries. No, markets are fantastic at distributing goods and services, encouraging innovation, and lifting people out of poverty. At the end of the day, though, we have countries. It's called the United States of America, not the United Markets of America. We have politics that trumps economics. And there are other dimensions to the common good that we're attentive to as conservatives and that are conducive to human flourishing. But one key component of it is undeniably markets. And every single historical example proves this. Israel, Sweden, Great Britain, India, all of these countries that tried the command and control system, all of them had to abandon it and liberalize their economy in the 70s, 80s, and 90s. And the results have been a colossal improvement in the state of living. My dad is from Israel. I mean, Israel basically started off as a semi-communist country. All of the guys who founded it were Eastern Europeans who were enamored with socialism. And then Bibi has his faults, but one thing he did in the 90s was he really opened up the economy. And Israel today is like high-tech, super booming economy across the board, not because of its communist origins, because of its the transformation of its economy along market lines. And I could give you countless more examples.